those countries banned the entry of homosexuals. Mm-hmm. And actually, Sir Elton John, when he tried to visit in 2007, I think, he had to get a special permit because the churches said that if Sir Elton had gone and performed there, all the people who were confused about their sexuality, they would become gay by listening to Sir Elton. So thus is the power of Elton. We also challenged some TV stations that refused to air a tolerance ad calling for respect for the rights of gays. That is before the Jamaican Court of Appeal, and I'll talk about that tomorrow. And we've challenged Jamaican anti-sodomy law. I was the lawyer for someone who had challenged the law before, but the person withdrew because of death threats, so I took over the case. So I'm now the claimant, and I have another lawyer. Okay, we'll talk about how that's going tomorrow. And we are also doing visibility campaigns. We're doing flash stands, pop-up protests. Because of the violence, we can't do organized, you know, in advance notice of stands and pride and that sort of thing. No, we do pop-up protests from time to time. We're also doing pride. In the way we do pride is we have most of it at a villa. And then my father, he drives a rainbow bus. My father, who was an evangelical, is now totally on side. And so we slap two big rainbow flags on his bus. He drives a tour bus. And we go to different spots around the city. We stand up for 5 minutes with our flags and placards. We jump back in and we drive to another location. We do that again. So we have a mobile parade. But it works very well. And so you're all invited to come down on October 16th and join us. It's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun. We've done report writing to international agencies. We presented the first thematic report to the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights on the situation for LGBTI people. And we've written shadow reports for UPR, Universal Periodic Review. We've also presented before parliaments of the region, which are going through reviews of sexual offences laws now to have them repealed. We're working with faith leaders, and I'm very happy about this piece because in the Caribbean, we know that religion is one of the major drivers, not the only, but one of the major drivers of homophobia. And again, as I said, my husband, who was a priest, he's drafted a letter which we're going to send to religious leaders. So I'm glad that there's a religious component here of this conference, to have them sign on to say that they oppose criminalization. Because in the case that I'm in challenging the Jamaican anti-sodomy law, I have 9 religious groups that have applied to be interested parties, saying that this law must be kept to prevent the extinction of mankind. Okay, so we need to get some more progressive voices on site. And I have to say that in Jamaica, we have some progressive voices. One is an Anglican priest named Sean Major Campbell, who, Father Sean, he refused publicly to marry anybody until he can marry gays. And for a straight Jamaican Anglican priest to say that, and his parish is downtown Kingston, that's pretty revolutionary. Okay? We're also, for Montego Bay Pride, we're having Bishop Sonyonjo, who was defrocked in Uganda for working with LGBT people. He's going to come and make a presentation on the role of the church and homosexuality. And we have Colin Coward, who says he's going to come. He was from England, worked on LGBT liberation for a very long time. So we're going to get the two perspectives, the Global North, Global South, to hopefully have some church leaders come and hear a more progressive position. So we're really doing a lot of work in that area. We're supporting homeless LGBT youth. Someone mentioned that, you know, they heard about the murder of Dwayne Jones, that LGBT youth was killed in 2013. We're trying to set up a shelter for homeless LGBT youth, many of whom are now living in sewers because they were kicked out as young as 10 years old for being gender nonconforming, and society doesn't want them. So we're trying to help fund that. And we're working with the diaspora by helping people to understand, in using their privilege, you know, being in England, in London or wherever, New York, how they can assist with liberation struggle back home. So whether to fund particular initiatives or to be out, because they can be out and therefore help their family and friends understand what it means to be LGBT. Because that's sometimes what's necessary. My family came around when they met me and met my husband and, you know, became kind of disabused of some of the myths that they thought about gays by just realizing how boring we are. We're very vanilla. so some of that, and I'm not saying, you know, non-vanilla is bad. I'm just saying some people Yeah, anyway, I don't know what I'm saying. So that's what we're doing to challenge homophobia. And I'm really excited. I'm so very sorry that I can only be at the first day, or at the first couple hours anyway, because I really want to hear about the religious component of this conference. But as I said, you all have my card. They're inside here. Please be in touch, because you can help. You can make suggestions. Just coming here today, I got a great suggestion as to how we can help to undo the 11 countries in the Caribbean that still have the anti-sodomy law, through a procedure which I hadn't even thought about. So clearly, you know, that's the benefit of these rich engagements. So that's my spiel, which I'm obliged to make when they pay for me to go anywhere. Now, I'm open to questions, comments, rude remarks.
You mentioned in your documentary that activists have this conundrum, right? Go via the court system or challenge the legislation. When we did it in Argentina, we said we did both.
Right.
We were very lucky that the government of President Kirchner at that time,
right,
Cristina Kirchner, the last president, she was behind the change in legislation. And as much as we did work very hard to take a case throughout the judiciary process,
right,
I think when you look behind, the whole debate that the bill, the Equality Marriage Bill, generated,
right,
in the country, made cement a cultural change,
right,
in society.
Right.
It was tougher. It was harder, and I guess we would have preferred to have the case law because of the work we had actually done,
right,
to get that case all the way to the Supreme Court.
Right.
But for the society perspective, to have that, if it's possible. Now, I'm not saying that it is always possible. That is something that,
yes,
I guess people from the ground.
Yeah.
I think that conundrum is true. And in my experience, it has been much better result because it really cemented the change.
So you are in favor of getting the legislature on side rather than going through the courts?
I would say, or at least in the Argentine experience,
right,
it was, in my view, an opportunity for everybody,
right,
to provide an opinion, to be heard,
right,
the parliament debate. I mean, perhaps Argentina is not the best example when you compare it to the Caribbean, because in Argentina we have never had religious marriage. It was abolished in the 1880s.
Right.
So we follow the French tradition.
Right.
So
right,
the debate,
right,
is still the Catholic Church have power.
Right. And then, you know, one of the things I've noticed in the Caribbean, the countries that have more Catholic influence or multi-faith influence are less hostile.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So for example, in Dominica, we had the bishop there support decriminalization. And when they measured the level of homophobia in Trinidad, it was like 60% tolerant versus 40% intolerant. So because Trinidad has, you know, multicultural, multi-faith. Jamaica now is a monolith when it comes to evangelical religion. You might have Anglicans, you might have a little Catholics here, and some Methodists thrown in to season. But not dominant at all. Evangelicals are, and they're literalists, and they are, you know, powerful, and they've infested all avenues, and I use that term deliberately, all avenues of our, sectors of our government. So getting a legislative change is going to be virtually impossible, because it's just like, this is, the Bible says, abomination, and there's no ability to engage diversity or, nope, you know. So the contexts are very important, but that's not to say we're not doing both, because we have made submissions to Parliament. We're reviewing our Sexual Offences Act now, so we've made submissions to Parliament. We are doing, you know, backdoor negotiations with the parliamentarians, but they basically told us that until we bring them a poll which shows that the level of homophobia is below 50%, they're not willing to move on the issue, because they're not going to buck the powerful churches. And the churches reinforce their homophobia every Saturday or Sunday. So, you know, That's why, as I said here,
the premier seems to have been in favor.
She's gone. She was voted out in February. And even when she was in, she said during elections that she would call for a decrim. And then in 2014, they said, okay, you know, you've had 3 years. What about this decrim thing you promised? She basically said she will not do it anymore because it does not concern the majority of Jamaicans who are poor. She was threatened by the churches. And then she was voted out in February of this year. And the new guy, he has gone to anti-gay massive demonstrations and protecting the natural family because he belongs to an evangelical church. So just like Argentina and Brazil, we have shifted right. So to my mind, the legislative approach right now is a non-starter. Hopefully, the courts will give us an opening. But again, it's very contextual and very situational. What works in Jamaica may not necessarily work in Antigua. Or, I mean, when we did the police training in St. Kitts, the police sent the police, the army, the fire, everybody was there. The leaders of the uniformed services were there with their staff for this training. They were very anxious. We couldn't find any member of the LGBT community. They were so deeply underground. But the administration seems ready to decriminalize, but there's no civil society asking for it. They're just not there. So it's very, the Caribbean is not uniform at all on this issue.
But why do you think that's the case? Is the same violence in all the Caribbean regions that it is in Jamaica?
No.
And if it's therefore that's not the case, why is so?
So Jamaica has recorded the most horrific violence. And I told my friends that I had some sad news to tell them. They were very upset about the murder of Dwayne Jones, and that's why they canceled the trip. Mm-hmm. On May 24 of this year, two men, lovers, were in their home in Montego Bay, my city. And thugs came and just sprayed their house with bullets, killed them, and then walked away. And when the police came to ask, the community said, nope, we're not giving any evidence because those were two fish. Fish is a derogatory term for gay in Jamaica. And so that was just a fish kill. And so they're not giving up any information. They don't care. It's just gays, I mean. So there has reached...
Isn't the same all over Jamaica?
That's the thing. It sadly is. We were hoping that it would be confined to the, but it's everywhere. We've had those kinds of incidents recorded in every, and then there's, it's very contextual because if you are have resources, you can insulate yourself. You can drive wherever you need to go. You can have a, you know, a job that protects you from being terminated because you are either a professional, a doctor, a lawyer, so you work for yourself, or you know, you have the means to go to your self, you know, your entertainment, you choose your entertainment that doesn't expose you to, but if you are not of means, you're very vulnerable. And so why that is, we can go through that tomorrow, but it is not a simple answer. The research we have done out of the University of the West Indies proves that it's both the religion and the music. We have the most anti-gay songs per capita. I think 200 plus, my murder musician specialist can. And just bear me out on that. We have the most anti-gay songs per capita of any country. And, you know, calling for the rape of lesbians and murder. And that now, as I like to say, that's music you hear Monday to Friday because we're not a quiet society. It's buses, trucks, you hear it. And then on the weekends, you go to church and you're anti-gay preaching. So you literally have a society that's marinated in homophobia because it's Monday to Friday. Music, Saturday and Sunday preaching, and then the politicians riff off that, and that's, they use a lot of the homophobic rhetoric in their campaigning. So it's very, we do not have a single solution for such a complex problem.
That is the state, sorry, I'm small. What happened? No, I was just telling you one more thing, I was just gonna shut up. That is the state failing on both grounds. First, not abolishing the criminalization, but then more important than what you are saying, or actually highlighting, is the incitement to sexual hatred and violence.
Are not doing, and that is why what the case we've brought before, the petition before the Inter-American Commission, and one of the reasons they issued precautionary measures in my case was because they said the government may not be themselves, you know, perpetrating the violence, but there's complicity because there's lack of any effective way to end it. There's no training or there's no campaign on tolerance. We're not talking about acceptance here. We ain't there yet. There's no campaign on tolerance, and there's just no support for ending this. There's no anti-discrimination legislation. It's just like, it's just the gaze, you know. So the next thing is, what's the solution? So we'll talk about that tomorrow.
I was wondering two things. One, this has happened elsewhere, but particularly in the Caribbean, the colonial influence that these laws were put into place pre-independence for so many places, and the move towards independence was quite often to resist and push back against the colonial structures that were in place. This seems to be embraced and held on to. And we saw in India over the last 2 years the same sort of trouble where they went backward in a sense to that. What's this piece, how does Jamaican society feel about supporting the kind
British
of structures that they have thrown off and resisted? I mean, Jamaican independence was extremely important for the rest of the Caribbean,
right?
After Haiti, you know, this large population demonstrating that you could go independent.
It's a function of, I suspect, most oppressed people that once, and I'm no sociologist, I'm just, you know, making stuff up here. But I really know, you know, once you achieve your independence, then to prove your viability, you have to show that you are more, you know, traditional than your overlords. And it's ridiculous because we have now hogged up this law, this British law, which Britain has abolished. We have now claimed it as ours. You know, it's a matter of national pride. And I remember having a discussion with a Jamaican consul general in Montreal and saying to him, you know, really, Jamaica should get rid of this law. It's a British law. And he said, no, Jamaica had 50 years of independence to get rid of the law. We will not get rid of it because it's now our law. We love it. And that's what Tracy Robinson, who used to be the Inter-American Commissioner on LGBT rights, and is a Jamaican, said. When in her research, she found that, nope, you can't use that colonization argument in relation to this law anymore. It's now so domesticated that we really think it's a part of our national identity. You know, and we think Britain got it wrong for getting rid of it. It's a bizarre state of affairs, but if you're a sociologist, have fun with that bit of research. But that's where it is.
Mm-hmm. And I wondered, has there been any pressure from outside of Jamaica? When we look at other things happening, when people are bringing sanctions, they're issuing travel warnings. In the Bahamas, we get a travel warning for our murder rate quite often, but I don't hear about any sort of external pressure.
The local community, well, there have been calls for boycotts and the local community has resisted it because, as I like to say, think if you want to understand how challenging it is for Jamaicans and some of the people in the small islands to challenge anti-sodomy laws, think of the smallest town you know, then surround it by a moat and fill it with sharks. Okay? People are trapped on those spaces. So Jamaicans to go anywhere in the global north need a visa. It's virtually impossible to get one for, you know, people who are the most vulnerable. And so if you impose a sanction, these persons would be the ones who would be blamed for the economic downturn. And so they would become targets. And we don't have anywhere for them to go. They can't jump in the car and relocate somewhere else. So we would be responsible by calling for a boycott for their deaths. So we've said, no, let's try other means. And it's really difficult for me to not support a boycott because Jamaica was the first country to impose a boycott on South Africa for apartheid. So the irony is glaring, you know? But we can't because we know the people who would... It would do more harm than good. So we're looking at other solutions, which I'll hopefully be able to get through tomorrow.
What about including... And I don't know the immigration laws and implications, but Jamaicans who live outside of Jamaica in the polls... Has that been?
What do you mean? In terms of, sorry.
Well, you mentioned polls earlier.
Oh. But they can't vote. They can't vote on Jamaican, you know, matters. They've relocated. They'd have to come home and be registered in a constituency
even
for some period.
Even
with a Jamaican passport, you'd have to come home and registered on the voters list, be in a constituency for a certain period of time. So it's not an automatic right. There is a process, unfortunately. So our government is looking at having. As a representative for the diaspora, where that might open the possibility for their voices. So in the meantime, I've said to them, well, what you can do is when you go home, you know, talk to your family about, while you're abroad, talk to them about inclusion, like, you know, disrupt the narrative that gays are this, you live in Canada or wherever, you see that gays are there and doesn't happen to the society. So you can do that. But in terms of affecting the legislative process, they can't. They don't have the right to vote. This is true. Any other questions?
Well, I have a follow-up question on that. So is the Jamaican diaspora view more progressive? Because like often, like in the US, for example, the Cuban diaspora is not.
Right. And that's a very good question. Because we find that once persons leave home, they become super nationalistic when they're in, you know, other contexts. And so they're not always the most progressive, no. And a lot of the time, when they hear about this issue, they respond, you know, knee-jerk reaction. Well, this is just Jamaica bashing. Jamaica is not. And they try to find every reason in the world to say, well, no, that's not true. That's not, you're making stuff up. Because a lot of them left Jamaica when things were not that bad. So their frame of reference is when Jamaica didn't have this really in this heavy influx of evangelicals that have now completely corrupted our one love culture. You know, I mean, we were never perfect, but we certainly were not as hostile. So their frame of reference is what they left back home. They are now reacting nationalistically. And so some of them are not as liberal, but certainly their kids who have been through you know, progressive education are more. And it's also a point, it's also difficult to get them engaged, those progressive ones, because they just think Jamaica is somewhere they go to vacation. Even though grandma might be there, they just vacation, they're really not invested. So it is really not a simple thing to get the diaspora engaged. But we've had some positive examples of diaspora engagement. So we're using all these tools. You know, the diaspora contributes more to the Jamaican economy than tourism. So clearly, if we can get them engaged in sufficient numbers, not all of them will be, but then it can help to hopefully shift the dial. Yes?
What is the position of the public education system in Jamaica?
On this issue?
Yes.
Okay. We went back under the previous government because UNICEF had done a manual which for teachers, a teacher's manual, which basically mentioned the existence of homosexuals. The Minister of Education, when he came in, the former one, when he came in, he's a Roman Catholic deacon, a very rabidly reactionary Roman Catholic deacon, who has a gay son, by the way, so that's crazy. But he removed the manual from schools because he said it would be training people how to become gay, grooming kids to become gay. And then he was replaced by an even more reactionary person. Because by the end of his tenure, the first minister, by the end of his tenure, the head of the Guidance Council Association said, in schools, kids who are LGBT are not given any assistance whatsoever because being gay is a crime. So if a kid comes to the teacher and says that they are struggling with their sexual orientation, they're reported to the proper authorities. That's what they say. We don't know what that means, but that, when the former Minister of Education saw that was what his policy had resulted in, he tried to backtrack in the last month before the elections and said, well, that's not really what I meant. You mustn't, we're not supposed to bully the kids, we're not supposed, but then he got voted out. And the new guy, he's even more reactionary. So there's no talk, there's no discussion allowed.
It would seem to me that that's a very difficult challenge to overcome.
But not impossible.
Because you're from the, you know, this size, you're building these little bigots the very beginning, and then in school, and then they go to church and they hear the same thing. Wow.
But there are solutions, and we are working on solutions. I mean, one of the things that has been very helpful for us is because of the power of social media. To youth, right? So we can't reach them through the formal education system. It's not possible. But we can reach them through more innovative ways. So it's not as if we have thrown up our hands. you know, and said, okay, I mean, people keep asking me, you're living in Canada now, why do you even bother?
That was another thing that I was thinking of when you were talking about the moat.
Yeah.
And I thought to myself, well, we don't really live in an area that has such a big moat anymore.
Yeah.
Because everybody has access to TV.
Right.
Everybody has access to social media.
Right.
And they've got to see over time, you know, how gay people are treated in other countries.
But
and in addition to that, and I'll just...
Yeah.
Is that, first of all, I don't understand, how is it that the churches in Europe seem to have been able to be accepting, because you have all these European countries
right.
that have had, you know, gay marriages for and accepted homosexuals for years and decades. So how is it there, it can be done there, but not here in the Caribbean?
Because our churches aren't European. They're mostly North American and mostly Southern Baptist or Southern US churches. And so you're talking about that. There you go. You know, just think Trump on speed. That's pretty much how our church goes. You know, but if you want the European context, and I'm very glad my friend here will talk about the European experience on Sunday, I believe.
Yes, indeed, Sunday. Also.
Right, but the Jamaican context is not there. Our churches are very literalist. I mean, some of our pastors, they have 2 years of Bible college, and that just means they can read the Bible and quote it verbatim. You know, in terms of research and what is that, hermeneutics? Yes, I'm married to a pastor, should know these things. But there's not that level of analysis or contextualizing or no. It's the Bible says you stone gay people. We might not stone you, and we're being kind to you by saying we're not stoning you. But no,
this amazing numbers of burners, motivated, sexually motivated. You have those policies from the government that not only is not protecting, but is somehow enticing.
Inciting,
cool.
Right.
And it's cool. I mean, this may be just a fantasy land that I'm trying to say, but are we sort of getting closer to a genocide to a certain extent?
Yes, this technically is called hate crimes.
Right, hate crime.
Hate mm-hmm. crimes. Hate crimes are ever the caused by prejudice.
Mm-hmm.
There are different kinds of, but in each discrimination, it's the theme of the genocide.
Mm-hmm.
That's true.
But, I mean, I'm talking because then just to make responsible, liable the state.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this is the only reason I'm bringing the issue, because it does seem to me that
in this case, it's the state because this discrimination is
right.
a discrimination.
Yeah. So you're talking about the pyramid of hate, which terminates in genocide. And that's one of the things we talk about when we do this LGBT sensitivity training. We are, as the professor had said, at the level of hate crime. We haven't quite reached genocide yet. And one of the things we have said to the Jamaican government is that, you know, these murders are happening to gays. And the response has been, yes, but we kill straight people too. We are a very violent society. We have one of the highest murder rates per capita. And because of that, the government says, and this is their defense, since we kill so many people, it's impossible to say that gays are being targeted. Of course, we've pointed out that, yes, you know, there's a high murder rate, but we don't kill the other people just because of them being gay. We kill them because they're in gangs or, you know, wrong place or not. There's a high murder, but we have a particular vulnerability, increased vulnerability because of our orientation. They just said, nope, well, you know, you can't prove that there's a deliberate targeting. We just kill everybody.
Space is equal opportunity.
There you go. I'm serious. This is their defense. Mm. There's no targeting of gays. We just don't protect anybody. And that's the state's defense.
Oh, as I said, equal opportunities.
Equal opportunities.
Right, so
exactly.
So the familial situation is that the parents, if there is a two-parent home, but even if there's only one parent home, that it's just pure shameful if if a kid comes in and says they're gay?
Kids as young as 10 are kicked out of their homes because they are considered an abomination, and because of the ideology that if you keep an abomination in your home, it will bring the wrath of God upon the home, you have to get rid of that. So there are challenges with you know, family reunion.
That was the difference with what Ireland just, you know, just a year past the whole of the country, you know, the referendum.
Right.
And I mean, Ireland in the 70s and 80s was the most sexist, bigoted,
right,
horriblest place to grow up, and very, very homophobic. But the family always came first.
Right.
And very Catholic, 97% of people are Catholic. But in looking, having lived in the Caribbean for so long now, and trying to figure it out, it was only with this referendum last year when you see 90-year-old grandmothers saying, sure, my grandson's gay. My own grandmother attended,
yeah,
our wedding.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And ripped the head off the person who came asking her to vote no,
right,
at the door. And but that seems to be the difference, is that family come first, and as powerful as the priests were, now they lost a lot of that power with the whole,
right,
kid sexual abuse thing.
Yes.
But as powerful as the priests were, they were never first before the
family.
The family was always first.
Right.
The priest could have came a very, very close second. So there seems to be that.
The family structure, yes, the family structure. Sadly, and again, I am no sociologist,
yeah,
right? I'm an activist and I respond to what I'm seeing. The family structure in the Caribbean, especially in my country, has suffered. We have 85% of our population born out of wedlock, and a lot of that is unplanned. So there isn't this desire for the child, and the support that should be there is being undermined by the priests, the evangelical pastors who are telling you that, you know, this child is a XYZ. And then in some cases, the new partner, the new husband, the new man, not husband, the new man, says he doesn't want that child, he doesn't want to take care of somebody else's child. If he's going to be with this woman, he doesn't want to take care of someone else's child, so that child has to be sent away. And the excuse is, the child is gay. Right? So you start a new family with somebody else. So I'm not sure what the context is in Ireland. I don't know how many are married and how many people are nuclear but large families. But here we just have, you know, in Jamaica, a lot of children are born out of wedlock. And there's, you know, different last names and that sort of thing.
But isn't that also then the contradiction as well? Again, picking and choosing, taking the Bible and taking religion, and actually saying, wait a minute, it's perfectly okay to do this, but not to that.
Because that's, you didn't hear what they, okay, so the guy from Uganda, the Minister of Ethics in Uganda, he was cornered by Stephen Fry on the issue of the inconsistencies. And, you know, but he said, but you all support rape of girls then. And he said, yes, but that's the right kind of sex. Right? Raping girls to the Minister of Ethics in Uganda is okay because it's the right kind of sex. Two consenting men in the privacy of their bedroom, that's different, right? He was a cat. He's again as narrow as you can get, and so they rationalize everything. So if you're thinking logically, you will get nowhere when you engage with these people. But we do have solutions. So come back tomorrow and find out.
Okay. Well, any other question? No.
Yes.
Yeah. Speaking of solutions, sorry jumping in, but I wonder, do you cooperate with other social movements in order to build alliances? Because my background is Russian,
right,
and there, well, it's a huge struggle among like vegans, anarchists, feminists,
yes,
LGBTIQ people.
Yeah.
And I mean, I understand this is a total different context, but then again, I see so much familiarity,
of course,
especially in those arguments like, oh, this is not natural to our culture because our culture is pure and this is something Western. And it's so funny to me that those like arguments and narratives appear somewhere else in Siberia, where I am from,
yeah,
like total,
yes,
total north, and it's theoretically the same, and I'm like, okay, so then where are those not pure cultures, those essentialists? So question is basically like, because it seems to me that there's so much sexism and misogyny behind
yes.
that as well. And like, do you like?
Of course.
Do you,
so we work very closely with the feminist movement, particularly because the source of a lot of the homophobia in Jamaica is patriarchy and misogyny, because the worst thing a man can do is be a woman, right? He has forfeited his natural role and allowed himself to be the submissive partner, and worse if he's the bottom. It's like, you know, so we know there's a lot of interplay, and we do, for example, in the presentation to Parliament on the Sexual Offences Act, there was a huge civil society coalition that included the women's rights groups, the children's rights groups, you know, disabled, all the marginalized communities, sex workers, etc., because we see this as our struggle. But the monolith of the evangelical churches and the hypocrisy of the evangelical churches, the ability to engage in cognitive dissonance of a magnitude you would never, you can't wrap your brain around, because it would drive you crazy if you're rational. That is something that has made it very difficult to make headways. But we are making headways. I mean, I've painted the situation very black today, but I wanted to bear in mind that there are solutions and we're working. But we do collaborate, but we have also had some pushback from some of the civil society groups. For example, when I tried to bring a challenge to the laws of Belize and Trinidad that banned the entry of homosexuals, we wanted to get the disabled, sex worker groups, etc., involved, because the same law also bans the entry of, and I don't kid you, this is what the law says, the physically and mentally defective, prostitutes. Now, they don't use any fancy language. Prostitutes and, you know, anybody that, persons who are addicted to alcohol, any infectious, there's a plethora of things. So we said, okay, this is a great opportunity to make common cause. And the group said no, they didn't want to be lumped in with the gays because it was still too stigmatizing. I think things probably have moved along now, but when the case was being brought, they did not want to be associated with us at all. We begged the disabled groups to come on board. Nope, they didn't want to be lumped in. So we do try, sometimes not successfully.